But you know, you can't swing around some of this too many times. It's really true. Every time it just keeps getting deeper in you. So I guess we will get started. I feel like Ante isn't here. I haven't heard from him in a bit. He's not that 314 person, I don't think. Oh well, let's just let's get rolling. How's everybody's break? Good, good. I hope the Easter Bunny came and saw you. I'm just gonna say I had a real life challenge of exactly what we were talking about. So I'm just gonna tell you about it, not to monopolize, but basically after class, I walked outside and my husband's sitting at a little table in the back and I say, how are you? And he's like, oh, not good. And there's this big crisis going on involving stepdaughters and money. And I'm just gonna say, yeah, if you wanted to design a trigger for me, couldn't have done a better job. It was like very, very, just, I could give you so many reasons why it hit me. So I'm like, I'm in the middle of this Buddhist class, but okay, this is going on. And so looking back now, I can completely see the first wave was cittas of delusion, cittas of greed, and cittas of hatred. The delusion is just that I forgot like everything that we had been talking about for like 3 hours. And I just went into this mode of like, I have to make something happen. And I got all like persuasive and trying to explain to my husband why I was so right and what should happen. And I just really did. And then I don't know what happened. You know, we kind of went around a bit and then I sat down and it was sunny and I kind of saw off to the left. I think of you, Francesca, because you were talking about seeing things, remembering them in spaces. Off to the left, I saw the lynx and I just went, oh, this is the lynx. And all of your support and inspiration was there, the Sangha as a jewel. And I'm not going to say, you know, the Walt Disney animated Bluebirds of Happiness came down, but I stopped. And as much like you described, Corey, I just felt like when you put on the anti-lock brakes and for a while you don't stop, you keep going, but I knew I was going to stop. And so I kind of watched it and I did stop. And I feel like, you know, something broke. And I'm not saying forever and ever, but something broke. And I just stopped trying to control my husband, basically. And, you know, it's not something I feel great about saying, but it's the truth. And so I took a walk and that helped too. And then I could kind of tell, you know, when I was starting to circle back verbally that it was inflaming me. So I just did, like Bhante says, some noble silence because my own verbal production was inflaming. I stepped back and, you know, it was just a very funny moment because it was so precisely what we had been talking about. And it was still really hard. It was really hard. These things are hard. But I experienced it. So I thought, well, this is pretty amazing right in the middle of class. So I thought I would tell you, you know, it goes on, it's live from Chicago. this is our human life. So yes, yes, theory and practice in the moment, but I do feel better. I feel like, you know, it's a drag the way it turned out for me really, but, so it goes. It's also a great victory the way it turned out for me, because I got a little bit of a break in some of my mental formations.
Yeah, you didn't tell us there's going to be lab work in this class.
I know. I didn't expect it. Thank you, Toshita. I mean, I didn't expect it, but it was really humorous almost because I walked out like, how are you? And, you know, before even saying how's class going, he's like, not good. So here we go. Yeah, but the lab work's so continuous. You do get breaks, but not always when you want them or expect them. So there we go. And this is just, you know, it is very live. So to take a little bit of a different break, I wanted to show you a poem I just really love that I think sets a nice tone. And let's see, it's by Carl Sandburg. Can everybody see it? And would anybody like to read it?
Sure, I'll read.
Thank you.
Last answers. I wrote a poem on the mist, and a woman asked me what I meant by it. I had thought till then only of the beauty of the mist, how pearl and gray of it mix and reel, and change the drab shanties with lighted lamps at evening into points of mystery quivering with color. I answered, the whole world was mist once long ago, and someday it will all go back to mist. Our skulls and lungs are more water than bone and tissue, and all the poets love dust and mist because all the last answers go running back to dust and mist. Carl Sandburg. Where's the punctuation in this?
What do you mean?
The period at the end?
Yeah, there's a lot of punctuation in it, actually.
Pearl and gray of it mix and reel. What a weird phrase.
Nice, isn't it?
Whoa.
Yeah. Yeah, it's really nice, isn't that? I mean, isn't it so Abhidhamma, you know, how the pearl and gray of it mix and reel? Because pearl and gray are not exactly from equivalent categories.
No.
And but yeah, mix and reel, that's what we're talking about. Yeah. And change the drab shanties, you know, change the relative world into mystery. And I like the way there's body in it, skulls and lungs, and all the poets love dust and mist and go running back to it. I just think it's a beautiful expression. I actually, you know, I do love poetry and write a ton of it. And, you know, I've done my 10,000 terrible poems that you need to do, but I actually think the Abhidhamma is very poetic in its weird way. And I think that illustrates it pretty nicely. So let's roll on. Okay, so now you kind of have a feel for where we are. You had your cittas, the 121 cittas, the 52 cetasikas. We see how they broke down into either, you could look at it, 5 khandhas, 12 bases, 18 elements. Then we looked at the wheel with the 12 links and how they move across that in both directions. So now we're layering on one more thing, which is the 24 modes of conditionality, or pachaya. Pachaya sati is the word for correlativity. I don't know whether the English or the Pali is more clear to me there, but it's the determination of the influence of a specific function. Pachaya is from I to go and pacha back, plus sati, wisdom or knowledge. So it's kind of wisdom or knowledge of the specific influence that goes back. And there are 24 of these modes, and this is the point where all the colors came out of the Buddha's pores. And there's a quote of my son's. He said, it's not that it's moving, it's how it's moving. That's what this is. So we've kind of got the that it's moving. We really do. It's all, we really see that it's moving. But this is how it's moving. These 24 modes are like describing 24 brands of motor oil or brands of glue or fluid in the joints or something like that. This is not so much even the moving pieces. This is kind of the floating, like we talked about the synapses between the neurons. So maybe we've been talking about like neurons connecting, but this is what's going on in the space in between. So, you know, that last book of the Abhidhamma, the Patana, is the exposition of these 24 modes of connectivity across every single detail and every single combination that we've discussed. And that's why it's unfathomable length and complexity. So this is a kind of condensation of this huge seventh book of the Abhidhamma. So I'll say like what some of the major factors are in these 24 modes of conditionality, and then we're gonna go through them. And what I'd like you to do, some of them are more relatable than others, but I want us to dig up examples as we go. I'm gonna put up something that has little example of each one, but I'd like to dig up some more real life ones. But the types of things that are involved in these modes of being together, one thing is timing and sequencing. So there's kind of a, you know, certain conditions precede others, certain follow. It's kind of, there's some sequencing and timing issues in here. And overlapping is an issue because some things need to overlap to condition things and some things need to go away to condition things. It's very interesting. And we'll think about that. And some of it is about particular functions. Some things condition other things by doing particular things. Like you have the boss, you know, the manager, you have the food, the feeder, you know, there's different kinds of functions of ways that we sustain, support, or condition other things. And another thing is valence. There's a little bit about the wholesome, unwholesome valence in here for sure. And then there's considerations of proportion. Some things, when they influence something else, it's boom. There's no other thing that you can even get in there to intervene. But some things are just a little influence, you know, so the proportionality is in there too. So it's, you know, it's not just about the chain of events, but it's about the subtle mixes of phenomena. And these are some of the things that are considered in the 24 modes. So I'm gonna put up a thing for us to walk through. If I can find it. Oh, sorry. Sorry, I thought this thing was out, but I think, oh yeah, here we are. I'm making you guys bigger, sorry, hold on. Alrighty, here are 24 aspects of conditionality, all right? So first, I am a couple of things. I'm gonna put all of these screen shares in Slack. I didn't do that last night, but I didn't have any last night, that's why. Okay, I'll put these all in. Also, I just want to thank you guys about the tech stuff because it's so nice not to actually have to set it up. There's just so much in my head. So thank you all that are doing that. And the other thing I want to say is that this is mostly in English still. And what I'm hoping is that Bhante can help us. I think there is a Pachaya Quizlet. So I'm hoping we can all start working on learning these 24 terms in Pali also, but I'm gonna just talk in English so we can get the ideas down for now. But the first part I do is breaking down a few Pali terms, pachaya being relations. And then you have the relating thing, the pachaya dhamma. And then there's producing, supporting, and maintaining. This is kind of like those three sub moments. I know, Lisa, you've been asking about this. And I'm not even gonna try to pronounce them, but they're there because That is in the mix too. What actually helps something come to be, what supports something so it can keep going, and what actually maintains it, or when it doesn't maintain it, lets it dissolve. And then you have the related thing, and then that word, pachayasati, is the correlativity, the determination of the influence of the specific function. And that's what these 24 are. So what you're going to see here is, like, remember when we were looking at the aids to enlightenment, and some words like mindfulness was the head of a list, but then it showed up in a bunch of other lists, and in some lists it was in the middle and balanced things, and some lists it was at the beginning and helped us see the list. So you're going to see this incredible mix of things that you know being used in different ways. And the very first thing is one of those things, which is root or hetu. So you know about the six roots, and you know a bunch of them as chetasikas, but here root, you know, so many terms are used in different places in the Abhidhamma in so many different ways. Here root is about something drawing a stabilizing, an event, drawing a stabilizing influence from the root factors in the hub of the wheel of life and death. So it could be delusion, the three unwholesome or wholesome roots. So it could be delusion or wisdom, it could be greed or generosity or renunciation, hate or metta. And what the root function is the quality of drawing those energies into the event. And its net effect is to stabilize an event and to kind of strengthen an event. Now, by an event, I can mean like a citta chetasika combination or a material phenomena coming in with it. So event is a broad term here, but for an example of a root quality, I just gave you one, a strong emotional trigger. So that, you know, pulls up these energies from the hub. Another one would be an urge to help others that pulls up the strong, wholesome energies in the roots. So it's interesting that it starts here and stresses the incredible importance of the wholesome and unwholesome in moving all phenomena. Just very core there. So hi, Bhante. We're just at the beginning of the 24, but you missed a poem, but we're good. Good to see you. So that is the root condition or conditioner. In every one of these 24 steps is very specified exactly what citta, chetasika, and material phenomena can be the conditioning factor and which can be the conditioned factor. And we're just going to look at like one or two of those, but I just want you to know that's all in there too, in the patana. So the next one is object causality. Object causes states to arise by touching upon them. And the object is, in quotes, highly regarded by consciousness. Now, an example I have is a catchy tune. Now that's an object. And this gets back to that thing about the mind is connected to the object, not the object connected to the mind. So a catchy tune, you know, the mind will just settle on that. And that is a strong object. And there's something about the way we're wired that a catchy tune really holds us for a while. So that's a strong object. Now there are two ways that the mind shifts from one object to the next. It's interesting. Now remember that every citta has an object and they're happening really fast. So there's just zillions of objects a day, but you either shift because there's an excess of a new object kind of bouncing the old one out, or you can shift by intention or vow or wish. So that's an interesting, another example of where intention is in the mix, not everything, but in the mix, but in a very important way. That's from the Atta Salini.
Could you repeat those two, Beth?
Sure. Either the mind shifts from object to, two ways the mind shifts from object to object. One is by intention or wish, and the other is by excess of a new object. So kind of like when you're playing pinball, you bounce one out because another one's coming along, or you can summon view and have some intention in object choice. That's kind of everything there. Okay, so does anybody have any examples of seeing an object cause happen where the object was what brought about an event? Can you feel that anywhere?
Maybe a sports analogy?
What kind?
Sports analogy?
Sports. How would it work, Lee?
So you're watching the batter, the pitch comes, he hits a home run. So you go from watching the batter to watching the ball fly out of the park. I don't know. Would that be something?
Yeah, no, absolutely. It's a visual object, but you could see like there would be such a rapid fire response to that because you have all this emotional association and connotation. And just think about if it's your team or it's not your team who hits it. Completely different event. But I think that is a good example. It's kind of nice because you also have the, you know, the actual object of the baseball. Sometimes we are kind of swinging at those objects. Yes, I think that's a really good example. Anything else comes to mind on object? Anyone? I think this is an important one. It's number two. And, you know, I think none of these lists have random orders. But we talked about this before. We are really object-seeking minds. So this is talking about that little force inside us. It's like looking for an object that doesn't seem to be so easily contented with choiceless objects. You know, as that phrase, they use choiceless objects of meditation. We tend to want to go find an object. We like objects. Okay, so then the next one is predominance. And this is like object, only more so. So this is one of those ones where the difference is really a matter of degree. Predominance is a really strong draw of objects to control mental states. Now we were talking about this just a while ago with video games came up and social media, I think is very good examples of this. I put obsessions because obsessions are like, we get really fixated on an object and when, you know, we just keep coming back to it and back to it, it's a strong draw. But that is part of our wiring that we do this. So any thoughts there on predominance of objects? Okay, I'm gonna drink some tea. Okay. Then the next one is proximity. And this is where the conditioning state draws the conditioned state right up by ceasing. The literal term for this in Pali means without anything in between. So it's kind of like I put one thought leads to the next, like how there's one citta at a time. And this is applied to citta frequently, that, you know, our cittas condition each other as they go along in a stream, but they go away to condition the next one. I'm gonna explain the next two and then we'll come back to this. Because the next one is another kind of twist on proximity called contiguity. And the literal term there means right next to. And this one is about a kind of a fixed order of things. So it's like the way the citta flow, there's no fixed order. It could be just like, you know, fairly much of a chaos system, really, with chitta flowing. But then you get something like, the examples are things like the seasons, or the 17 steps of a perceptual process. Now that is a fixed order. So this is where one thing pulls the next thing up, but there's some kind of a organic defined universal principle behind the way it's going. So it's similar, because the first thing comes up and leaves for the next thing, but then maybe the next thing's a little more predictable. But remember, even in a predictable sequence, like the 17 steps of perception, you have all the chetasika variants, you have many ways it could be shortened or not, or respond to the object differently. So it could be a fixed sequence, but just because the months all go in order doesn't mean every August is exactly the same thing, right? You know, so it's kind of like that, but it's kind of a variant of proximity. And then the next one is conascence, which is in contrast to 4 and 5, where the thing that conditions the thing has to be with it. Okay, the language gets hard, but the conditioning thing and the conditioned thing need to exist together. So this is like what we learned about citta and cetasika, what we learned yesterday about the four elements. There's no one element sitting there by itself. It may be dominant. It may be the one that we see and experience the most or feel the most, but there's no one element hanging around there. They're all together and need to, conascence, you know, meaning born together, they arise together and they dissolve together, and they have the same object and base. So these are very, very linked causes in this conascence condition. Now, the classical example of this that Letty Sayadaw uses is that the sun is like a consciousness event, and it arises with heat, which is like the chetasikas, the coexisting mental states, and with light, the coexisting material qualities. So you can't really pull it apart and say the sun's going to come up and then it's going to, well, it does kind of actually work that way, but the heat, the immediate heat, will be with it, although it builds. And the light builds too, but it's all part of the phenomena. So the difference between 4 and 5 and 6 is really important. And it's interesting to think about this. What kinds of things need to go away to make the next thing happen? And what kinds of things need to hang around? Like one example is a seed to a plant. The seed needs to go away for the plant to happen. I mean, you'll still see the husk of the seed and everything, but the seed turns into the plant. If the seed doesn't go away, the plant is not going to happen. But on the other hand, you take something like the sun, and the sun needs to happen while the plant is happening, or the plant won't happen. And I think of this a lot with parenting also. Now, there are certain ways that you might help your kids or help your friends or help anybody that you need to kind of hold their hands and walk with them through something. And there are certain kinds of things that you cannot help them unless you let go of their hand and they do it. And you have to cease your conditioning to really let them get conditioned. So it's really kind of an interesting, important difference there. So any thoughts on that one, or examples you can think of, of something where you can see where your influence needs to coexist with what you're influencing, or where you see your influence needs to stop to let the influencing thing happen?
The best I could come up with is driving a car on the road. You come to a stop sign or a stoplight or a yield, we'll go with a yield sign.
That's good.
Something needs to slow down or stop for something else to come past.
Mm-hmm. So if you don't stop your influence, you are going to cause a crash, basically. Yeah. No, that's good. It is kind of like that kind of imagery.
You would cause a mental conundrum if you had the crash.
Yeah, you would. You would cause...
I got one.
Yes. Oh, of course. Yeah, you definitely did. And but then that also makes me think of merging. Yeah, and Kyle's clapping for you, but for sure. Yeah. No, that's good. And merging is a little more like the proximity. Merging, you have to work with it. If you don't merge with it, then you cause another kind of problem. But you have to stay, hang in it, and merge versus the yield sign. No, that's very nice.
What would say, I guess it's a different part of your mental processing, but would you say overthinking would maybe come into this? Like I was trying to think of that. The baseball analogy came to mind again. If like if you try to think too much about how you're swinging or how you are, like if you're intentionally trying to get involved with that, then you're getting in your own way.
I think. Yes, I think that works, because what you're explaining is sort of where, and in a way it's similar to the not yielding idea, I think was you're building on that, where it really would work better to be a contiguity situation, but you're turning it into a connascence. You're holding the influencing condition too long. So it's good if you think about it, you get up to bat and you swing. But if you think about it, you get up to bat and you're still thinking and thinking and thinking, you're holding that influencing condition too long, sort of past its prime of influencing. And then it becomes a hindrance. It really becomes a literal hindrance in Buddhism, which I would say is like almost like speculative doubt. Mm-hmm. You're overthinking. So maybe that's really interesting, Dave, because that makes me think like speculative doubt could be an instance, like everything weaves into everything, but speculative doubt could be an instance of exactly what we're talking about, where you kind of cause a connascence influence to occur where a contiguity would be better, if that makes sense. You're holding on to it too long. I forget the word, vichichichi or something, vichikichi. There's a great term. Yeah.
Vichikicha.
Thank you. Is that mental scratching?
Yeah, kind of doubt.
Yes, yes, exactly. Thank you. That was it. Yeah, so that's a kind of what I think you're describing, David, and definitely a sports issue for those who are more cerebrally inclined. I get it. Okay, so let's roll on to mutuality, which I talked about earlier and is really interesting. The subtype, it's a subtype of connascence. So connascence it's not that it's really different, but connascence as a concept there emphasizes the existence together. But mutuality emphasizes the reciprocal influence, that there's so many things like this, where they condition each other at the same time. And I said, like the three bundles of sticks or wheat leaning on each other. The arising, you know, on the small scale, the arising of citta and cetasika, that is really, really reciprocal. You can't pull it apart. I put people in partnership. I think this is so similar, you know, and that's why it gets so tricky, because the influences are so circular. And so mutual. And in a certain way, in every interaction, I think there's a certain kind of mutuality.
Can you scroll down?
Oh, yes.
Thanks.
Sorry, I lost track of where you were. There you are. Yes. Thanks, Corey. Yeah, so there's your mutuality. I was just thinking, what was that? That was like a helpful thing. And then I scroll down and then he can see, and then he can let me know to scroll down. I mean, just so many things go like that. So what is there something else that strikes you as a very balanced mutuality condition?
Like here in the Sahajata Pacheya or connaissance condition, The four immaterial aggregates are mutually connected, and also four great essential Mahabhuta, you know, Pathavi, Apo, Tejo, Vayo, earth element and fire element, water element and air element. They are mutually connected. And also Nama Rupa, materiality, mentality, the name and form, they are also mutually connected.
Yes. That's really
awesome. Yeah.
It's really, yeah. And so this kind of
even chetasika, you know.
Yes. Yeah, these very basic thing, you know, pieces of our vocabulary are moving together. And while we take them apart to look at them, we really always have to remember what Bhante is saying. They don't exist without affecting each other simultaneously. And this is another dizzying factor here, but it's the way it works. Okay, we'll roll on if you're good to support condition. Now, this is just the raw dependence of the conditioned on the conditioning for support to happen, to stay alive. Like the trees to earth is the example. The classical example is that the material bases are the standing ground for sensory perception. So it's just like if you don't have this part of your body that does this chemical or mechanical tiny thing, there's no way you can have a sense consciousness. So that's the basic, you know, you need this to stand on feeling. And decisive support, again, I guess, is one of those stronger versions. Decisive support has a kind of quality of being support, but in a kind of really strongest, dependable way. And the object is like the major reason for the event happening. My example there is like samvega that we talked about, that feeling where you feel really urgent about practicing. It's not just like you have a vow or a wish that would support a practice, but you have some vega, you have a driving urgency to support your practice. So that's kind of a distinction I think might work there. There are three types of this, this condition. A bunch of these have subtypes, but this one I thought was interesting. One is objective decisive. Is it decisive support? Yeah. Objective is very much like that predominance object. It's just more emphasis on it being the reason. So some objects have this quality of like being really decisively supporting. And proximity based, so some things are really decisively supporting because they're right next to it. And natural, this one, natural decisive support is a little confusing, but it kind of means that I put proper and thorough in sort of quotes, because that's something from a Bhikkhu Bodhi class asking about this, but it just means kind of ordinary or naturally occurring sort of motivation as a decisive support here. But in all these qualities, decisive support means this is the thing you really need. You may have like lots of friends, but you have your BFF. That's your decisive support, kind of like that. Okay, then the next few are about timing. Again, prenascence means the manifest state has to arise after conditioning, and the manifest state has to arise. That's confusing. But prenascence means something has to be there before the thing it conditions. And just by being there conditions it. So it's very much like that proximity one. Let's see, sensory chittas and chetasikas arise after sense bases. Okay, yeah, I think we kind of use this example before, but the sense bases or the objects have to exist before the sensory chittas and chetasikas can arise. So that just means it's got to be there before. You got to have the setup before it's going to happen. That pre-nascence is the setup. Now, the post-nascence is kind of weird because it's the opposite. It has to be there after the event to condition it. And that's sort of weird, but another Bhikkhu Bodhi quote here is it's like refocusing. So conditioning states assist conditioned states that have already arisen by supporting and strengthening them. So for instance, you know, I put like, if you think about something and you're smiling and you think about it, you'll smile more. The material phenomenon of the smile will kind of increase if you keep thinking about it. Or like if there's a tree and it rains on it, the tree is there, but this post-nascent rain is helping the tree and supporting it. So that's a kind of a weird one, but it's there. There's pre-nascent and post-nascent. Any thoughts on these? These are kind of timing ones. It's a little technical about sequencing.
Sometimes the good karma that you did in the past can be helpful for this time to make a better good karma.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes, the bad karma also can be helpful for you to do more bad karma, more right. Worse, right? So they can be mutually helpful. That can happen.
Yes.
So kusala, akusala, it is said, purima, purima, kusala, dhamma, pachimanang, pachimanang, kusalanan, dhammanang, upanise, pacho, sahajata. These are all actually helping each other.
Yes. Right. They're like just reinforcing each other as it goes along. Yeah. And these are just like these kind of minor variations, but actually karma is coming up, as you can see, as one of the conditions. But yes, they're reinforcements for each other as it goes along, as it being the events in the consciousness and the material events mixing.
Let's say take an example from the modern context, like you are more familiar with McDonald's or the coffee, you know, so you can recommend to other people, now if you are hungry a little bit, okay, we can stop by the McDonald's, because you know you are familiar with that earlier. Mm-hmm. That taste is more familiar to you. So you previous experience, previous taste is helping you to experience the current taste. You yes. can also share with the others.
Mm-hmm.
So that
I'm trying to think of a post-nascent event. It's very difficult, but like maybe, I don't know, if you eat McDonald's later on, you know, they kind of put things in it that make you want to eat more McDonald's. So maybe that post-nascent event is kind of comes back and strengthens the urge for more McDonald's.
So let's say like you ate something sour, or you had some very spicy food, and you know, now afterwards you feel the effect of it, you feel the burning sensation, and that is, so you don't, you really kind of, maybe you don't like it.
Mm-hmm.
And I had this, so the post-nascence maybe mm-hmm. that you don't really like it.
Right. And instead of strengthening that event, it makes it less likely to occur again. It decreases it because you have had sort of an aversive reaction. Yeah.
But even without eating, you know, you think, if I eat this, this will happen to me, so I should not eat it. You know, that can be, I think, more appropriate in that case.
Mm-hmm. Right. And a conditioning doesn't mean you make it more likely, it just means you affect how likely it is. So it could mean you make it less likely, like in that example. I know this is getting confusing, right? But it is confusing. Okay, so rolling on to repetition, this is a little more straightforward because this refers to the Javana series specifically, which repeat the same type of, the same formation of citta and cetasika are repeating, like pulsing seven times. So this is, you know, about that, but it works on a bunch of scales, and it's creating and reinforcing future karma. And just like Bhante said, if it's, it could be like reinforcing it in a negative way or a positive way. But repetition, you know, as we all know, is a force in itself. Repetition is an incredibly important force. That's why we have rituals, personal and public. You know, repetition is how we learn. It's like classical conditioning, and it's like neurons firing. The more a neuron fires, the more likely it is to fire again. So repetition in itself is a huge force, even though it's specifically referring to the Javana series here. Those were the examples. Any other thoughts on just repetition? I love repetition because I think that things that you repeat become much more vivid to you. But not when you overdo it. Okay. Then the next condition is actually kama. So this is where our universal cetasika of volition is going to condition all action and future states at some time. As Sayadaw says, Letty Sayadaw, kama latently follows the sequences of mind. So there's so many examples here, and Bhante gives a lot of good ones, but if you're kind to someone, at some point, you're gonna feel good. You might not feel good right then. You might even not feel good in this lifetime, but that is one of those impersonal universal principles that at some point that comes around. So I call that intentions trail. And it's in all of the cittas, and kama is affected by all of, or described by all of these other conditioning factors. We're gonna look a little bit in a minute about the ways that this can be synchronous or asynchronous, meaning that the kama effect can be pretty immediate or delayed. But it is always in effect. And then the next one is called result. And this is kind of one where it's kind of, it's just a bit of a weaker version of kama, not a stronger version, but it's kind of the tail end of kama. It's the natural evolution of intention. It's more passive. It links prior kama to resultant cittas. And it's just kind of the tail end of the kama force, you know? And I don't exactly understand how it's different, but it is the result of the kama, just where it really links in with the resultant citta. For instance, ruminating strengthens a negative mental formation, and then it causes it to arise more readily in the future. And we all notice that, I'm sure. You know, the more you brew on something, the more you're just building it in. That's also a repetition effect. Now, these effects are not one at a time, just by the way, you know. So anything that happens, you could, say 12 of them that are going with it. And they do with everything, you know, later on. But yeah, so a lot of these happen at the same time. But that's kind of the tail end of kama effect. Let me scroll on down. There you are, result. Now, from here down, I don't know if you would agree with this, Bhante. Bhikkhu Bodhi says that these ones are kind of afterthoughts of the commentators a little bit. And they kind of, they aren't so basic, but they give some more ideas about how forces can condition each other. But some of them are important still. And the next one is nutriment. And this is just like what we were talking about yesterday with Rupa. Nutriment can take many forms, and it is a whole Nama Rupa event. Nutriment is not just like food, not like just at McDonald's. There are lots of forms of nutriment. there are four types actually: edible, contact, volition, and citta. So that's very interesting. Contact, volition, and citta are so strong in conditioning other states and so necessary in supporting and maintaining them that they're actually considered kind of nutriment of the state. And nutriment isn't about like the food, it's about the force of material and mental maintenance and support of states. It's like the maintenance of the state is the nutriment, what it takes to maintain it. So that's the broadest definition possible of what nutriment is, but it's another really good example of nama-rupa. It's just like, you can't separate it out. There is a force underneath any phenomena that helps sustain it and gives it nutriment. The next one is faculty condition. Faculty condition is kind of like the bossy ones. This is when a condition really is controlling and has less strength and is kind of governing, like runs a specific department or area. So there are a whole lot of different types of faculties, indriya, and we came across jivitindriya, if I'm saying that, you know, the life faculty, the energy, the animating energy. But there are many kinds of faculties, and they, an example would be feelings, the way they can really strongly run a coexistent state of consciousness. And the life faculty does drive karmically derived material qualities. These are like faculties that are very strong in directing the force, kind of the, almost like an adverting thing, but they're directing the force of conditioning. I would say another example of this might be practice efforts to concentrate. You know, when you're really trying to concentrate, it's just crazy how hard it can be. But I think that those are faculty types of conditioning where you're like really trying to direct consciousness for a period. And I think that's a feel of faculty. Okay. Then the jhana factors are listed from among the beautiful chaitasikas. They condition states, mental and material states, to fix on an object. So this is kind of a practice point thrown in, that there are also conditions, and it's similar to kind of what I was just saying about faculty and trying to concentrate. There are conditionings of our efforts and practice. And that's what that's referring to. Like you try to train yourself to stay with the breath.
I had a quick question. Maybe I'm just drawing a blank since it's Sunday afternoon. I thought there are five jhana factors, not seven.
There are.
Five.
Oh, did you say something, Bente, there? I don't know why. Sometimes there are four and sometimes there are five, and I don't know why there are seven there.
There are five jhana factors.
Yeah.
Piti, sukha, and ekagata, right?
Yeah.
But jhana-wise, if we take, sometimes it is first, second, third, fourth jhana, and in some cases, we also have fifth jhana. Because vitakka and vichara, they sometimes break into two. So then it becomes another jhana.
Oh, if vitakka and vichara broke into two, then you would have seven.
Jhana factors, do you have seven? I think we have five jhana factors for sure.
Vitakka, vichara, piti, vedana.
Vitakka, vichara, piti, sukha, and ekagata. Vedana also is there, right? Piti, sukha. That is, actually, vedana is sukha, you know. Piti, the vedana is sukha vedana, the happy feeling.
You know what? I think I remember something, but I'm going to look this up for you, Corey, because I'm not sure, but I remember something where they had the feeling factor breaking into positive and negative. But I don't know the answer to that, and it may be a typo, but I have a feeling there was something there. Thank you for asking, and I'll check out that for you if I can find it.
So in the five jhanic factors, one is vitakka, and then vichara, and piti, and sukha. So sometimes sukha is also used as vedana, sukha vedana.
Right.
Of course, in jhanic experience, you don't have dukkha vedana, it is sukha vedana.
Right.
And then the other one is the ekagata, the concentration.
Right. The one-pointedness. That way, yeah.
Five, I don't know if you have seven.
Yeah, I don't know either what that's about. I'm going to have to track that down. I know, you know, I kind of pulled together from a few sources, so I'll be able to find either where that is or if it's a typo. And I will get back to you. But I got to write myself a note on the cover of this so I see it. And that is number 17. Okay. All right. I know you will all be holding your breath for the answer to that one. I hope it's not a typo, but could be. Could be. So thanks. Good notice there. Really good. Because this is everything we've done is kind of interweaving here. I think, how are we doing? I'm gonna go ahead and just run through the rest of the 24, and then we'll chill out for a bit, because it's getting a little easier now. Okay, path is another practice thing, which is the directional effects of the chetasikas, path conditioning. So this is just talking about moving in a wholesome, moving in an open, moving in a liberating way for you and others. That's that conditioning. And the next six are weird and repetitive, okay? So there's association and dissociation. Association is just to make the point that the citta and the cetasika coalesce entirely in an inseparable group. So it's an instance of the mutuality. And then dissociation is about states supporting each other because the mental and material aspects are different. So it's about mental states supporting material phenomena and material phenomena supporting mental states. So it's just to, I don't know, somebody's very structured mind wanted to put that as a conditioning thing where the, you know, the actual point of the conditioning is that they are working across domains like that. But we've talked about a lot of examples of this, like the sense bases support sense consciousness. So the material base supports the mental phenomena. Kama influences the realm of rebirth. So this is where mental phenomena like volition will strongly affect immaterial phenomena like type of body. Really important. So the point is that they support each other across these domains and dissociation. Then what you have is presence, absence, disappearance, and non-disappearance, which actually cracks me up, just the phrase non-disappearance. But I think you all are looking a little past the humor of it. But presence just means it has to be there. It's very much the same thing as conescience, has to be there to condition. And absence, like proximity, means it has to go away to condition. Now, these other two, it is said, were added to make a middle way point to differentiate from the heretical views of nihilism and eternalism. So disappearance is, again, like proximity. It has to go away. But the reason it differentiates from nihilism or nihilism is that it was there. You know it was there and it existed. Then in non-disappearance, which is kind of like being there, it takes away the idea of eternalism because it's not gone yet, but it's gonna be gone. And so you know it's not gonna last forever.
Can you scroll down, please?
Oh, sure. There's your last, I'm sorry. Thank you so much, Corey, for keeping me on this. Okay, so as your presence, absence, disappearance, and non-disappearance, they're kind of flips on the same thing. And the logic is a little scrambly because you're saying things like non-disappearing, so they right away scrambled. But it's a great word, you know, like if you know, if you want somebody to hang around, could you say, please non-disappear? You know, I don't know. I just like that. But anyways, that idea is that they were put there to kind of emphasize some middle way philosophy. But I would say, you know, the last four for sure are repetitive and are making that point that is very vital, that sometimes to condition something, you need to be with it and be conascent and sharing in its existence. And sometimes to condition something, you have to kind of almost like sacrifice and be gone so that the conditioned event can arise out of the conditioning. And that's a core thing that runs through here. All right. Do you have any questions or would you like to mull it over break?
I somehow messed up my sequencing. Can you tell me what 20 is?
20 is the dissociation state. Sorry, Lee, because I wasn't scrolling. Dissociation is the one where the mental qualities condition the material and the material condition the mental. So they get, I would say the last four are repetitive, the last six are very structural. And then the jhana and the path are very practice oriented. But otherwise they kind of speak for themselves about influencing conditions. So I think we should sit with it for a bit or not, you know. So why don't we get back at 4:15 and try to sift through and see if we can talk about a little bit more concretely about how it all works.
So I'm cool with that. I was just going to say real quick, in the book on page 312 on jhana conditions, it says that it's conditioning states are the seven jhana factors, which are reduced to five chetasikas.
What book are you in?
The
CMA one.
Yeah.
Okay, so that must be where I got it, but I still don't understand it. So I'm going to look at, thank you. I'm going to look at Nina Van Gorkum and Letty Sayada later. Okay. All right. Cool. All right, let's chill out and we'll be back at 4:15. Good.
Thank you. But you would not have displeasure in the actual jhana states, for instance.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. Thank you so much. That's it. That's displeasure in the community. Yeah, it is adding more feeling tone in there. Mm-hmm. Yep. Thank you. Okay. Good. I like when it's not a typo. And also, if it can make sense, is fun too. Thanks, Sherry. Okay. So so we're back, and Sherry answered our seven jhana conditioning factors, not seven jhana state absorption factors. So thanks. And are there other questions? Like just thinking of either the specifics of the 24 or what it means just that they're there. Yeah, the complexity now is getting to a pretty intense level, right? Yeah, because we're combining what are already very complex systems. But we're talking about how they combine. So Bhante is going to help us out here, and we're going to kind of switch gears because my mind feels pretty filled up. And we're going to do a Quizlet and look at the Pali for these 24. So I have the Quizlet up. I think, here we are. I have to Do you guys see the Quizlet? Yay.
Yep.
Okay, I got to move you all to the side, sorry, because I got to do this, but we'll just go through them and Bhante will give us the pronunciation and then maybe we'll do one quick test. You ready? Okay, root condition.
Did I give you before? Here in the Quizlet itself?
I don't know, I found this.
I think I have. Pronunciation.
Oh, you might. Oh. Where would I find that?
Let me see.
If you go back home.
Go back home.
Yeah, it is there.
And then go to the Patana class.
Root condition. Yeah.
The
pronunciation. And then scroll down.
Go to Abhidhamma class. And then this one, right?
Yep.
All right, Abhidhamma class. Patana class. Okay, so where is the pronunciation?
Keep scrolling. There you go.
There, who goes here?
Yeah, so you see the little speaker to the right of each.
Okay. Okay. Why is it not in order?
Can I share the screen?
That would be good.
Yeah, Beth, y'all have to stop.
Oh, I have to stop. Okay, no problem. Got it.
Okay. Okay, over here. So.
Hetu pachayo.
Root condition.
Aramana pachayo.
Object condition.
Adhipati pachayo.
Predominance condition.
Anantara pachayo.
Contiguity condition.
Samanantara pachayo.
Immediacy condition.
Sahajata pachayo.
Conascence condition.
Anyamanya pachayo.
Mutuality condition.
Nissaya pachayo.
Dependence condition.
Upanissaya pachayo.
Powerful dependence condition.
Purejata pachayo.
Prenascence condition.
Pachajata pachayo.
Postnascence condition.
Asevana pachayo.
Repetition condition.
Kamma pachayo.
Kamma condition.
Vipaka pachayo.
Kamma result condition.
Ahara pachayo.
Nutriment condition.
Indriya pachayo.
Faculty condition.
Jhana pachayo.
Jhana condition.
Magga pachayo.
Path condition.
Sampayutta pachayo.
Association condition.
Vipayutta pachayo.
Dissociation condition.
Atthi pachayo.
Presence condition.
Natthi pachayo.
Absence condition.
Vigata pachayo.
Disappearance condition.
Avigata pachayo.
Non-disappearance condition.
Okay. Is that
okay? We know them all. Kidding. Okay. So
you can practice later on.
Yeah.
As you wish.
Okay. Well, it's good to hear them. I like that mutuality was like onomatopoeia. How do you say that again?
Anyamanyapachayo.
That sounds like it. That's cool. Okay. It's good to have that. I will also include on the Slack, I have just a listing of the words in the Pali, if you want to see it in another form, but we can work on Quizlet for later. But I want to rest the brain a little bit. Because now I'm going to just do a little bit of weaving. but not a ton. Because I think it gets just actually to a point where it's almost too dense and it's almost better to read it. But there are two things I wanna look at where things kind of mix with the 24. The first is when you look at some of the conditions, all of the conditions, what I mentioned how they're specified exactly which materials, material phenomena, which citta, which cetasika, can be conditioners and can be conditioned. And I'm just gonna look at two of them because I think they're interesting. And would it help to look at it or should I just say it?
Visualizing is always.
Helps you, okay, okay. This is gonna be, it might be one of the, this is one of these things where I took a picture, so it might be a little small. Okay, so it's this one. I have no way to make this bigger and I really apologize.
This looks really good. Looks good.
You're okay?
Yeah.
Bonte has to put on his glasses. But anyways, we're just looking at that mutuality line. But this is from a table where, as you can see, every single one of the conditions is listed in terms of the conditioning states and the conditioned states. So it's telling you what of everything we've studied can go into conditioning or conditioned in this. And I think the mutuality one is interesting and important. So I'm kind of looking at that. The hardest thing about this table is it's filled with these English abbreviations that are difficult. But mutuality, the conditioning states are the same as the conditioned states almost. So both, what it's saying is both at rebirth and in existence, the 89 cittas and the 52 cetasikas are conditioning the 89 cittas and the 52 cetasikas. So here we're doing the 89 system, not the 121, but the point made in line A is just that the cittas and the cetasikas are mutually influencing each other. Then, as Bonte mentioned, those are the, that's the four great essentials. Those are your four elements, mutually. And then for the last one, it says same as 6C, which is right above. 6C says, at rebirth in the five aggregate planes, the four mental aggregates and the heart base are the conditioning states. For the heart base, what it says here is the heart base supported by the mental aggregates supported by the heart base. So here you have your mutuality of the bases and the aggregates. But it's a little funny to me because the heart base is separated out as a conditioning state, but in the conditioned states, it's completely circular with the aggregates. The state, the bases and the aggregates. I'm losing altitude. It's so complicated, but the point I want to make here is that these are the classical ingredients of the mutuality condition. Okay. And then I want to look at one other one of these that I like. If you want, the table is in the comprehensive manual of Abhidhamma. And it is just kind of interesting because there are, you know, as Sherry was saying before, very specific things that we've studied that work in like the puzzle of this. But the other one is, this one up. Oh, that did not work. I'm gonna have to just read this. I don't know why that did that. Anyways, okay, I gotta read it. that little line in there, that's kama, the kama condition. And this is where I was talking about conascent and asynchronous kama. So conascent kama that just, you know, directly and immediately brings up its results is conditioned by the volitions in the 89 cittas. And what it conditions are the 89 cittas and 51 of the 52 chetasikas, because it takes out volition, because volition's kind of already involved. And they're conascent. So in this case, kama is involved. I'm going to stop the share because it's not working. Sorry. In this case, kama is involved conascently with mental processing. So the importance of this is that kama is immediate sometimes. As you are having these arising chittas, they are actually conditioning the chetasikas, except for volition, which is doing the conditioning. And that is immediate kama. So things are happening right away. The point here is that one chitta pulls up the next chitta, pulls up the next chitta. And as we described, you can apply some intention to change the object, but there is a force in kama that is just following the trail of the chittas, that small and that immediate. So this is, I know Bhante is going to teach us about kama, but this is just to say that within the system, the kama effect can be very tiny and immediate, and it's always in there. Then when they talk about asynchronous kama, that's when they're talking about the bigger effects that can show up later. And that's where they say that the past wholesome and unwholesome volitions condition the resultant chittas and the rebirth linking. So that is where kama is asynchronous. It's not conascent anymore. And these are the two types of kama condition. So I think the take home on this about the kama is that it's operating on so many scales, but there is a kind of immediate kama, like the quote that I think was Letty Sayadaw, where he was saying, you know, kama latently follows the trail of cheetahs. It's right in there, but it also is making for the big effects. So I think that's a kind of a nice explanation of the ways that we have present and future influence by our intentions. And it's weird to think that you're influencing the present because the present's already present, but you are. Okay, I have one other thing I'd like to bring in. Oh yeah, okay, you got that. I just was checking the chat. And this would be, there are a bunch of ways that these 24 are divided up. I do not think they matter. This is something in the Visuddhimagga, but I think it's very much like the Patthana, where now we're going to take the links of dependent origination that we talked about this morning, the 12 links, and describe them in terms of the 24 modes of conditionality. So every link not only has certain constituent variables, but they are also mixed according to certain modes of conditionality. And I'm only gonna look at one because it is probably the most relevant that we've been talking about all day, is how craving is a condition for clinging. And this is gonna explain that link in terms of the 24. All right. I think it might be another one of these shrimpy ones. It is. I'm really sorry. I'm going to have to read it to you and that'll be hard, but.
I think you can zoom in that, right?
Well, you know what, Bhante? I did a bunch of these. they're screenshots.
Yeah, you can go to screen.
The screen you had up before was big.
I know it was, and I don't know what's happening with these ones. I must have just cut them really tiny. Like yeah.
If you go to view, you can go to view and then zoom in. Yeah. Now it's good.
Now it's good?
Yeah.
Seriously?
Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'm going to try and move it over and get you. Well,
it's centered. Oh, now it's really big. Now it's off the screen.
You're kidding. Not off my screen. All right. You can see now?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you all very much. All right. It totally doesn't look like that from here, but as long as you all are happy, I'm good. This is how craving is a condition for clinging. And it's going to talk about it in the terms of the 24 modes of conditioning. And it's just an example. I don't think we need to go through the whole wheel and the 24 modes. Bhante could go through the whole patana in his head, but we don't need to. This, I just want you to have a feel for this. And this in the Visuddhimagga, there's already pages and pages back, kind of building up to this, but for the first in a single way, but for the three remaining kinds in sevenfold or eightfold way. Now what they're saying is there are four types of clinging. The first type of clinging has just one condition they're going to mention. The other three have seven or eight types of conditions. So as regards the four kinds of clinging taught in this way, craving for sense desires is a condition in one way as decisive support for the first kind. So that first kind of clinging or craving for sense desires is the only of those 24 that they're putting in as decisive support. That one that is like where an object is really strong and it's supporting the existence of the conditioned state in a big way. It's like the sugar daddy of it, okay? It's really supporting it. Okay, but then the other three, sense desire clinging, the other three, there are seven ways. So the other three, remember, are associated with wrong view. So they have a kind of broader base. And there are seven ways. Conascence, so the conditioning factors are existing with the clinging. Mutuality, they're actually supporting each other. Craving and clinging are actually building on each other. Plain support condition, association and presence, which as we saw are just kind of like saying the same thing, and your non-disappearance, and also root cause, which is very important. That's the first one. So with the clinging, you're going to have some kind of unwholesome karma or unwholesome cittas. And so you're going to pull up some of that energy from the root in your clinging. And when is the condition as decisive support, then it is never conascent. I guess that just means that when it is this really strong support, it is one of those ones that goes away before the clinging starts. Yeah, so decisive support relates to the sense desires. So it goes away before the clinging, but the other ones have more mutuality. The wrong view ones. Okay, so this is I think because the craving for sense desires arise from the object field, it kind of precedes the clinging and it gives way to it. But the other ones coexist with the conditioners, the clinging to wrong view, rites and ceremonies, or doctrine of the self. Because the chetasika wrong view is conditioned in seven ways that I just read. So I think the idea here is that the wrong view as a chetasika is more with the connection, and it's kind of gluing the craving and the clinging together, whereas the object craving goes away and just leaves space for the clinging. So I think what it helps here is that when you're trying to break this chain, most of the time it's about separating out something in the present, like I was describing about my break. It isn't so much like the object went away, but my wrong view in the present was making for the clinging, and I had to separate that out to move. I'm gonna stop sharing and stop talking for a second. Does that bring up any ideas just when you can see how complexly everything is laid out? Or is it just maybe a little too much complexity?
I used to chant this entire Patthana maybe for the last 1 month or so. I've been chanting every single day, including today. So it takes around 1 hour to chant, but the more you chant, the better you understand. I almost learned it by heart now.
So I wasn't kidding that he does chant the whole thing, but Bhante, when you're chanting the Patthana, I mean, are you chanting the whole book?
No, the 24 Patthana.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but also like around 1 hour. So it gives a kind of idea, all the Patthana, all the 24 have been explained.
Okay. Yeah. So the chant you're doing takes an hour, and it is a list of the 24 with explanation.
Yes.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
And you have it memorized?
Yeah, I think it's pretty easy to remember because they are very familiar with me already. Mm-hmm. Those things, you know, like Pure Jata, as we mentioned, like you are familiar with the previous experience. So this one is very easy to remember. And they also have this repetition and the same kind of formula. So it's not that difficult to remember. Here we notice that most of the five faculty thing, rupa, like eye, ear, nose, you know, tongue, body, these things are being related to these pachyas in many ways. Mostly this, and then the form, the sound, the smell, the taste, and the contact. These are the things that we find almost in all 24 pachyas in different ways.
Mm-hmm. Well, that makes sense because they are explaining, you know, human experience. So those are kind of our ingredients. It's almost like the khandhas, that they are broken down how they are interacting in the pachaya. But I really do think it would take that kind of capacity that Bhante has to really, really absorb this, because it interacts so much with everything. I'm gonna read you a quote about what we've just done. This is from Andrew Olensky, who Bhante is a, you know, that guy you were corresponding with. And he has a beautiful 4-page outline of Abhidhamma. Is that in the Slack somewhere? It's pretty incredible. He's a great study, but this is what he says. In summary, the Abhidhamma describes how 28 physical phenomena co-arise with 52 mental factors, manifesting as 89 types of consciousness, which unfold in a series of 17 mind moments. You're recognizing all these things, right? Governed by 24 types of causal relation. That's it. That's all. Okay, and you got basically all of that. So 28 physical phenomena Bhante taught us yesterday. You have a feel for that. They co-arise with the 52 chaitasikas that are manifest as 89 types of consciousness, the 89 chitta list. And they unfold in these 17 mind moments over and over and over. Could be more, could be less, but roughly. And they're governed by these 24, this list of 24 that we went over. So that's kind of like, in a nutshell, what we've been doing for weeks and weeks and weeks, and what we will continue doing for lifetimes and lifetimes and lifetimes. But that is just the interweave in a sentence. But it's mind-boggling, but you do have the vocabulary for all of that now. And so you can kind of think through any piece of it that you want. If you relate to one aspect of it more than others, then use that as your base. Like sometimes, like Lisa, you've been talking about the 17 steps. I feel like you've been really, really looking at those. So think about the 17 steps in terms of the 24 modes, you know, or plug in something else, but take your base and anchor yourself where you feel the most kind of simpatico with a list. And then you can filter the others through. But basically that's our layout. That's what we have just done basically. And it is, you know, when you think about this, this is the architecture of the Buddha's vision. And we don't have the 3 months to be devas and go through the whole thing, but we've kind of like sketched it a little bit, this kind of sketchy version. So tell me your thoughts or where you are now, besides, are you tired and it's Easter Sunday and stuff? Oh, and I see another cat.
You know, it is said the Abhidhamma Pitaka, like everything is impermanent, right? Mm-hmm. So including the Dharma will disappear one day. So it is said out of the Tripitaka, 3 pitakas, Abhidhamma will be the first to disappear because it is hard. And you know, already you feel it.
Yes.
So the monks in Myanmar, they make a very conscious effort to take care of Abhidhamma. So they preach Abhidharma. They even the lay people, they say when you keep chanting like Pathana, it will be very good, very helpful. So you say the benefits of it. And so they keep chanting the Pathana. Mm-hmm. Pathana is one of the, it's like, as we learned before, when Pukkusati, you know, he said, and also there was another one. They both came to the Buddha and asked for a shortcut to Nibbana. So the Buddha talked about 5 faculties, you know, take care of your 5 faculties, that will be your shortcut to Nibbana. Mm-hmm. And the Pathana, I felt the kind of essence we have in Pathana is truly wonderful. It can, the more you read it, actually, the more you feel it. Mm-hmm. And it's really amazingly interwoven, all those ingredients together. Yes. So it's very useful.
Yeah, and we're so fortunate that you are chanting it for us and for all beings, because I feel like, you know, it is really true. The Abhidhamma is really difficult in a lot of ways. But, you know, I'm kind of hoping that we are a bit of an American revival of it, because I think it has been mostly in like monastic and academic circles. And there's, you know, we could do it here, and we kind of went through everything. And like Bhante says, like the more you study it, I really can't believe, you know, I still feel like I'm a baby, but every time I get back in there, I just, you know, more of it makes sense and is felt, and the purpose of it comes through to me more. And I, you know, the purpose of knowing these things, but I think it's very left hemisphere. Do I mean left hemisphere? No, I mean right hemisphere. And if we want to relate to the Buddha's teachings, I think we should stretch every aspect of ourselves to meet the Buddha, because I think the teachings came in every form. They're in poetry, and they're in story, and they're in plain talk, and they're in structure. And the more ways we incorporate it, I think that the deeper it goes into us. So I kind of, you know, really feel like this material should be available to everybody. And it's manageable. It's not easy, but it's manageable.
I was wondering, Bhante, if you have that chanting book in English and in Chinese?
I think I'm sure the Chinese version should be there too. I can find it if you want.
What about in English?
In English, yes, I shared that one today.
Oh, okay.
I shared in the Slack. Mm. And if you like, I can actually chant a little bit of it. Not the whole thing.
That would be really good. Well, I see some like fatigue factors. So why don't we take a break until 5? And maybe you could chant a little if that's okay, Bhante, really?
Right now?
No, when we come back.
Sure, yeah.
Okay. And then let's, you know, just kind of wrap up. And let me know where, I just have a few kind of wrappy up points, but I'd like to know if you can, where it's sitting with you. Okay, so we'll come back at 5 and do that. Thank you.
That's our little ritual. Everybody gets up, we bow, we go downstairs to the main floor and stand around and go back up the flight of stairs. Yeah.
Yeah, I think maybe it is more than 3, though.
It's more than 3.
a flight is maybe half a floor.
Okay.
So, some of the flights are short.
It does turn, yes. The Abhidhamma of the stairs at Mava.
Yes. Yeah. No, I had the good fortune to visit last February. Mm-hmm. Bhante was there too. And it's beautiful there. I mean, I really do look forward to a time we could actually be there.
Yeah. It's been unusual for us.
Yeah. I'm in many groups and a couple of sanghas that, you know, have found a way to stay together. It's a kind of a weird phenomenon, how we translate to the Zoom life.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it is way better than not being together. And, you know, I'm in summer going to be transitioning back to my office, and I'm not looking forward to it in some ways.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Will you be coming for the final?
I think, aren't you taking the finals at home?
No.
No, no, no. That would be awesome.
They're in person.
That'd be great.
We watched you take them, but you were at home.
No, we were at MABA.
Oh, this is the big
planning, actually, right? So after the COVID, we decided to have it online, but maybe we could meet in MABA for the final. That will be great.
The mock exam's done at home, but last year we did the finals at MABA with big spacing between us and webcams watching us.
Yeah, sorry, I mixed up the mock exams and the finals. So the finals are in the summer sometime, and you'll be together. And
mm-hmm.
Oh, I see, in July. Mm-hmm. Well, that would be really nice.
The weekend after the July 4th.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that'd be really nice. And you all will be working really hard on your finals, so I imagine, but it would be really nice.
Yeah, lots to memorize.
Mask and face shield, everything.
Yeah.
So, okay, let's take a break and then Bhante can be, you know, he doesn't get the break here, but if you could give us a little, soothe our minds and then we'll talk a little.
Bhante is muted.
So I would like to chant Anantara Pachayo for you. And it is, I hope it will also be very helpful. It takes maybe a few minutes. I took a little bit longer one so that it covers more aspects of Pathana. That okay? So in the PDF that I shared in Slack, you can also see number 4. If you want to have a look at the chanting and the meaning side by side. So that will be very useful too. Or you want me to share it here? I can do that too if you want. Okay, I can do it here actually. Okay, let me share it. Over here? Can you see?
Yeah, we can see.
I hear some construction work going on at the temple. So I don't know if that is a good time to start. They are drilling.
Yeah. I mean, we can hear you, but if it's hard to do it.
You also hear the background music?
A little bit.
Time to practice tolerance.
Yeah.
So this one talks about the chakku, the eye, and eye consciousness, and how it is related to the mano, mano dhatu, the element of dhamma, the mind, and they are also related to, you can see here, eye consciousness element, and its associated states are related to mind element, and associated states by contiguity condition. So it goes on chakku and then manodhatu and sota manodhatu and ghana manodhatu, jivha manodhatu, kaya manodhatu, and purima. Purima means preceding kusaladama hosam state, also related subsequent to wholesome state. So previous wholesome states are helpful to subsequent wholesome states. And then purima purima kusala dhamma pachimana pachimana abhyakatanam dhammana. So preceding wholesome states are related to subsequent indeterminate states. And purima purima kusala dhamma pachimana, that means preceding unwholesome states are related to, you know, subsequent unwholesome states. And same, preceding unwholesome states are related to indeterminate unwholesome states. And then you can see preceding indeterminate indeterminate states are related to indeterminate states, subsequent indeterminate states, and then subsequent wholesome states and subsequent unwholesome states. And so this is about this. So I'm going to chant this Anantara Pache. Okay. Hope you gain a good positive energy. Anantara pachayoti chakhu vinyana dhatu tang sampayutta kacha dhamma mano dhatuya tang sampayutta kanang cha dhammanam anantara pachayena pachayo mano dhatu tang sampayutta kacha dhamma mano vinyana dhatuya tang sampayutta kanang cha dhammanam anantara pachayena pachayo sota vinyana dhatu tang sampayutta kacha dhamma mano dhatuya tang sampayutta kanang cha dhammanam anantara pachayena pachayo mano dhatu tang sampayutta kacha dhamma mano vinyana dhatuya tang sampayutta kanang cha dhammanam anantara pachayena pachayo ghana vinyana dhatu tang sampayutta kacha dhamma mano dhatuya tang sampayutta kanang cha dhammanam anantara pachayena pachayo mano dhatu tang sampayutta kacha dhamma mano vinyana dhatuya tang sampayutta kanang cha dhammanam anantara pachayena pachayo jivha vinyana dhatu tan sampayutta kacha dhamma mano dhatuya tan sampayutta kanang cha dhammanam anantara pachayena pachayo mano dhatuya tan sampayutta kacha dhamma mano vinyana dhatuya tang sampayutta kanang cha dhammanam anantara pachayena pachayo kaya vinyana dhatu tang sampayutta kacha dhamma mano dhatuya tang sampayutta kanang cha dhammanam anantara pachayena pachayo mano dhatu tam sampayutta kacha dhamma mano vinyana dhatuya tam sampayutta kanang cha dhammanam anantara pachayena pachayo purima purima kusala dhamma pachimanang pachimanang kusalanang dhammanam anantara pachayena pachayo purima purima kusala dhamma pachimanang pachimanang abhyakatanang dhammanang anantara pachayena pachayo purima purima kusala dhamma pachimanang pachimanang akusalanang dhammanang anantara pachayena pachayo purima purima akusala dhamma pachimanang pachimanang abhyakatanang dhammanang anantara pachayena pachayo purima purima abhyakata dhamma pachimanang pachimanang abhyakatanang dhammanang anantara pachayena pachayo purima purima abhyakata dhamma pachimanang pachimanang kusalanang dhammanang anantara pachayena pachayo purima purima abhyakata dhamma pachimanang pachimanang akusalanang dhammanang anantara pachayena pachayo yesang yesang dhammanang anantara ye dhamma upajjante citta cetasika dhamma ye te dhamma te sang dhammanam anant pachayena pachayo sadhu sadhu sadhu. So I used to chant this entire 24 pachayas like this. I keep doing it. I don't know if you heard it properly.
Yes, we did. We did. If there was ever like a beautiful example of like a sublime state mixing with a mundane state, we just experienced it. Yeah. It was gorgeous. It was so, thank you for doing that, Bhante. And I know it must be hard to like stay focused and have to sing that loud over the construction. But that was really helpful because it sort of showed you, like he went through the contiguity condition and it showed you all the sense bases relating to the mind. You know, that was your dissociation too. And it showed you all the sense consciousnesses relating to the mind element, and then all the mixture of kushala and akushala mixing together, what leads to what. So that was just the contiguity. So you can imagine each of the 24 layout with all those details, but that explained it so well, how it lays out. And it was also incredibly, it did give very good energy through the construction and all. So thank you so much for doing that. That was a great effort for us. Thank you.
I think that's why the chanting can really help us learning by chanting. Eventually you learn it by heart.
That's right. So much detail, but if, you know,
very useful.
And you've been doing it your whole life, but it is really useful, and just the melody of it and everything helps. So so where are you with all this? We really have, we're going to, you know, next weekend lay out more of the kind of path aspects and the practice aspects and the parts of the Abhidhamma that I think relate more to these sublime states and these truly developed consciousnesses. But I think that what we've done, you know, in the past few weeks is really laid out the human realm and what the Abhidhamma tells us about it. So how is everybody, and where does it land for you?
I think that for me anyway, it's a bit of a tangled web in that I can sort of conceptualize how this fits with everything, you know, especially because it seems like a lot of these, you know, because when a state arises, it can be more than one of these at a time. And so it sort of just, I was sort of thinking of it in a way like visible light spectrum and colors, in a way like the photons themselves could be chitas, and the vibration that they have is innate to them. It won't go away. So that's like chetasika. But then if you look at how they manifest as visible light, they might be combinations of each other in a way. And so that's like a quality of how they're relating to each other to bring about something. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's not a perfect analogy, but it's just, it's a way that I'm struggling to understand it.
No, I think it's a very good one because as you said, the photons have their own kind of reality, like a Dhamma. You know, you can't reduce that. And it is a kind of universal principle, but how it manifests is extremely intricate and complex. Yeah, I think a lot of this material you've all studied before, like you know the khandhas and it sounds like you've done the links on the wheel a lot, but a lot of it I know like these 24 modes, that's all new stuff, so it's just you know first glance it is not going to weave perfectly right now, but it's like three-dimensional weaving. It gets really like a lot, and you know your body will sift through a lot of it. It really will, I hope. Yeah. Bhante, could you take the screen share down? Because I have a picture that kind of relates to what Jeff just said. This is just a visual that I like to use. Can I share? Yeah, I mean, it's just a picture on the beach, but you know, there's your causality. And you know, there's some experiment that they did at UCLA and you know, where they were doing artificial intelligence. And this is kind of old news at this point, but every kind of systematic programming for artificial intelligence that they came up with was not as good as something modeled on a dust ball, which had all this kind of chaos potential, and the AI could learn in any way. And that's kind of more how causality looks, I think. It's not like we could make a flow tree of this. It's kind of more like that, and they're infinite. And it's like, you know, neurons or like, you know, stars in the sky or anything, or galaxies. They're just infinite ways to combine, but within, And this is kind of what Jeff is saying, there are infinite ways to combine, but what you're combining has a natural unitary presence that is beginningless. Any other thoughts? I'm gonna throw out one more Dogen quote. Remember Dogen, Ehe Dogen, who did that thing about the steel yard scale, balancing and emptiness. Yeah, here's another thing from a quote from a fascicle called Juki, I think. Affirmation is the translation of that. And I think it's kind of a nice how to move with this thing. Truly, intentional production of circumstances and non-production of circumstances should both be investigated by relying utterly on the principle of turning from one moment to the next. That's in italics. Doing and not doing should be investigated by relying utterly on the principle of turning from one moment to the next. That the Buddhas and the patriarchs are now being realized is because they are being turned from one moment to the next by activity. So Dogen knew his Abhidhamma. I think that's a good practice take home from it. There's so much information, but just keep turning from one moment to the next. Just keep aware that turning from one moment to the next has more ingredients in it than we could ever conceptualize. And that we cannot know this all. We just can't. We can lay out a whole lot of it, but we can never know it all. And we are just turning from one moment to the next. And I think that's the best you can do with all this material. It's all process. So anybody else have anything to throw out on this?
I'm kind of wondering if it would help to go over some more examples for people. I mean, I know it might help me a little bit, but is that where other people are?
Can we do a little more? And examples of what, Jeff?
I was thinking, like, in the beginning when we were looking at, you know, root and object and contiguity and connaissance, we were kind of talking about, like, what would that look like?
Right. Well, I have an idea. What if we talk about an event and then apply what of the 24 we think would go with that event? Okay, Lisa, you're shaking your head. Will you give it, do you have an event in your mind? And
No, I don't, sorry.
That's okay. Should I put back up the 24? Okay. Actually, I might have a better. I might have a better list for you. Do you remember them enough to just, are you seeing that list, first of all? Do you remember them enough, the English is on the right, to use that? Because I want you to have it all on one page, if you know, pretty much, if you can. Okay, so are you okay with that? All right. So let's take an example in regular life and an example in practice. So who could throw out a regular life example for us?
So one I was kind of thinking of earlier, I'm glad that you talked about going backward in a way from what we had been doing, because I was trying to do this earlier and sort of failing. Mm-hmm. I remember one time I was observing mindfully and I heard what sounded like gunshots and a lot of gunshots. And I had this instant sort of realization of surprise. And then following that, I could see the recognition that this was fireworks. So there was then the reaction to that in my mind, that sort of change. So it seems like in that example, if we were to work backward from like the initial recognition of gunshots, if it was. So I sort of get confused, because if we say that, I mean, the sound itself would be object, right?
Yep.
Then it kind of gets tangled, because like the sound gives rise to a feeling of surprise or recognition, maybe, of the gunshots. I'm sure there's more to it than that, but mm-hmm. you know, as you go along, proximity or contiguity, like as it rises into another sort of thought process, it seems like it's several of these going on at once. Mm-hmm.
That's hard. Well, it is, because you're talking about a series of events. So let's just take a small one, which is your reaction to the initial sound. So you have like a fear reaction and a thought. So let's break that down. I'm wondering if root condition might be in it in the sense of delusion, because you didn't know what was happening. Not sure on that, if that would be classically correct, but definitely object condition. Definitely, and I would say predominance, because that object is so strongly causing the citta. I mean, it's a gross object impingement. So I'm gonna go with predominance. What else would you throw out? Do you think we're talking proximity, contiguity, or connaissance?
I have trouble because of I can't remember all the definitions very well.
Yeah. I'm with you on that, Jeff.
Yeah.
I was like, yeah, well, that's true. It's a good question. What are the differences?
Okay. Well, proximity is the one that has, I'm pretty sure, yeah, has to go away. These two have to go away to cause the event.
So the sound would have to go away to cause the surprise event?
Well, The sound wouldn't have to go away, but the citta that registered the sound would have to go away, I think. I think it is contiguity and connaissance, because the sense bases are the support condition for the citta that arose.
The thought or the interpretation comes after the sound. It's a fixed order, right?
Yes, and the reaction, like we're even
reaction before, and then thought, yeah, right. Or exactly. Interpretation.
Exactly. So I think we're in the proximity contiguity zone, not the connaissance, because it's not like the sound and the citta arose together. The sound arose and then the citta. So I think that's there.
So the sound arose and then you labeled the sound.
So could we start from that 17th step? So first, there is the sound. Then the vibrating bambaga chop off the wave to receive the signal.
This is hard because I'm not sure what size unit we're working with, but the sound is, you know, the whole registration of the sound is the whole 17 steps we're talking about.
So we are talking about after it's registered. But where do we plug in these?
At the javana, right?
Javana?
So the whole mental process. So he hears the sound, and then he labels the sound as gunfire.
Hear and label. So right. That we already passed the receiving and investigating.
He only initially thinks the sound is gunfire.
Right.
So more
that time. So isn't that at that time already past the investigating, because he thought that would be the gunfire based on his past experience? It sounded like a gunshot.
Okay, I this is getting super confusing. But what, let's say this. Okay, there are 17 mind moments in the actual sound perception. But then we're talking about the next thing that happens, okay? So he's heard this sound, he's registered it, and then objects are entering at the mind door now. That's what we're talking about, okay? Mm-hmm. So because a material phenomena lasts 17 mind moments. And of course, it's that same 17. So... okay, so he's heard the sound, but now we're talking about the next mind moment. Associations are coming in at the mind door, and he's associating gunshot. So I think in that sense, the object is a prior conditioner. That's how I would put this together. But it's really complicated. And I think so. We're looking at that moment of scary gunshot thought. And so I believe that the object and the object predominance are contiguity condition and support condition.
So then I'm wondering, you know, there are all the other conditions too, okay. And some of those might fit too.
Yes.
You know,
let's look down them. It could be decisive, powerful support, object decisive support, where the object is really, the object being that sound is really, really supporting this next citta flurry about what it is. And I think it is probably a flurry, not just one citta, but okay. So let's go on down. Do you think it's prenascence?
I think if anything, it could be post-nascence. And
tell me how that's working.
I'm thinking the condition came because maybe he has heard gunshots in the past.
Oh, that's interesting.
That's Yeah, I don't want to interrupt. I just was going to say that's sort of where I was thinking, like, there's some residual that I'm pulling in from the past that I did, that starts to identify that. And it's, yeah. Is it repetition? Is it comma? Is it post-nascence, pre-nascence? Probably not comma, but, you know, just I have trouble with that part of it too. Like, how are these all really different when it comes to practical understanding?
Yeah. So am I wrong in thinking that pre-nascence would mean like this would be the first time that he's ever potentially heard gunshots?
I'm interpreting their story, but it isn't about like having heard it before and recognizing it. Pre-nascence is about, did the gunshot, did the event of hearing the sound predate this citta of, oh, scared gunshot. So it did predate that citta. But I'm thinking that you're bringing up an interesting point about post-nascence and the whole idea of conditioning.
Well, the reason why I mentioned it is because we had talked about the spicy food before.
Yeah.
And I misunderstood, but like you ate this dish that was too spicy for you. And the next time that dish came around, like, you know, months later, or you saw it on the menu or something, and you're like, no, I don't want this because I've had it before and it was too much for me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think if we're just looking at his reaction, I don't think technically learning goes into post-nascence, but I don't know. I have to think about it. I think it's an interesting point that that what you know conditions things that are arising. So I don't know. I really don't know about that. I think technically it's not post-nascence, but I think it's an interesting usage. Because the reason why I don't think it is technically is because his reaction is not supported by, that would mean his reaction was supported by later things that are there. But yeah, I guess that's what you're saying. The later things are his experiences and fears with gunshot. So, and that way I think it is. Sorry, I just went around in a circle, but I can see that point. So some experience or memory he's carrying, some tendency towards an association at the mind door is already present and is coming back to condition this event. I would call that a way to look at it as post-nascent condition. Repetition condition, I don't think really applies here. You know, here you are talking about like, I guess, like if his reaction kept repeating, that would be repetition condition. It's not really referring to the object repeating here. Is that working? This is hard to unravel, but I don't really think it's repetition. What do you all think about comma condition? It's a hard one.
I think it depends on how far he went with his mind state.
That's a good point. Mm-hmm. Can you roll that out a little?
There's a couple different directions I was thinking, like ruminating on the sound to a point where it causes fear and worry is one potential thought I had. The other one where if he reacts and calls the police on something that was just firework related, which I believe out in your area, Jeff, fireworks are legal anyways. So it would have been a non-emergency call. There's a couple of thoughts that I had in different directions, but the biggest one would be like towards the self, where it would cause fear and worry towards the self.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I think that also, no, that makes sense, is if he starts ruminating and building on it in the mental formation. Now, we're not just talking about the initial reaction, but if the initial at the mind door creates some ruminating, then here we are going into karma condition. Mm-hmm. And it seems like conescent karma, right as it's there, the cittas are building on themselves and creating more reinforcement of that mental formation of fear. So that would be, if this reaction goes on, some conescent karma is building. And then where we're talking about intention is like you have the capacity to notice that and say, wait a minute, take a deep breath. Maybe there's another explanation, that kind of thing. But now we're going, you know, down into more events. But that would be actually, I think, a switching into a conescent, wholesome karma. So remember though, we're talking about, you know, we're describing a very small event, and these are how it can proliferate. I think this is interesting though, to look at different ways it would proliferate based on different conditioning variables here. And karma condition might have to do with the momentary volition, like that comes with that reactive fear. So that is a conescent karma of that very moment, but then it could build in different ways. Let's roll on. Result condition is that one that is the tail end of karma. So if there's a strong, say there's a strong volition with that moment of reactivity, then it could also go into result condition. All right, nutriment condition. What do you think on that one?
Doesn't really seem like that one fits as nutriment, but
yeah.
Well, does it get into the mental aggregates?
The nutriments were those four sources, which were the citta, the volition, actual food, and something else. Hold on. So I don't think it fits so well either. Contact. Well, there is strong contact in that event. But I think that the contact nutriment is in the sensory event. I think the reactive event, I don't see as nutriment condition. I have to say that what we're doing now, I gotta admit, is pretty opinion-based. I am not sure, you know, that unraveling this, you know, I think you could probably go to some Abhidhamma scholars who would do it very differently.
Yeah, I think that as well.
Well,
yeah.
I don't know if it's so much opinion-based. Like, I think if it's personal-based, because it's based off of each person's mental state. So like if Jeff had complete total understanding of this entire list, he would be the only one who could actually accurately describe it.
I think that actually, like, if
or Abhidhamic scholars, but
yeah, exactly. Yeah,
I mean, like in this room right now, like right. He would probably, otherwise all of us are probably just like, well, I could see this, like, because right. Yeah, that's why I mentioned, like, it depends how far did your mind state go. It could be this,
right? You know? It it depends what unit we're looking at, and we're trying to stay with that reactivity moment. But it's not a completely opinion, because we have some information here that we're sharing about it, and we are flushing out ways to look at it. But yeah. I just want to say, like, my call on it is just how I'm seeing this particular thing, and I'm not sure that every, you know, Abhidhamma scholar in the world would be right with us all right now. But let's just, you know, muddle through it, because it does illuminate what the conditions actually are and how we apply them. And I think it was a very good idea to do it, Jeff. So, okay, that just with that said, where were we? Okay, nutriment, not so much. Faculty condition, this directing, organizing thing. I don't think so much either, but does anybody feel like faculty could tie into that reactivity moment? I mean, I think the faculty energy is quite different than reactivity energy. It's kind of when you're marshaling the states. So I don't see it working so much there.
I was thinking along the lines of what Corey was thinking about the personal inputs into which conditions are going to occur, because I live in a neighborhood where we've had, you know, lots of shootings over the past year. There was a drug house about a mile away and people were shooting each other there almost every night until the police finally arrested them all. And there was a murder recently, not too far from me, that was on the news a couple days ago. So in my neighborhood, when we hear shots, we immediately get on next door and start trying to figure out, no, where was it? Was it, you know, at the drug house? No, that's been closed down because they've all been arrested. But, you know, which block was it in? Where was it? And you can see all the reactions different people have. Some people are immediately, you know, yelling online, I'm going to leave. This is terrible. We have so many shots. And other people are start talking about other things, like
making, you know, how terrible hearing it.
Yeah. We start talking about what was in the way that blocked the sound, and we're analyzing it. And other people are thinking about, you know, what caused people to do this. So, I think, for instance, the nutriment condition, the gunshot itself is not a, you know, there are other nutrients that come into how you would interact with the gunshot. Like, yeah. Do you immediately feel threatened by this personally, like you're attacked for living here? Or are you viewing it as something, you know, a sad thing that has happened because some people are making unwise choices, living unwisely, living through terrible things. So the citta that results is going to depend upon the roots that are arising when you hear the sound also. Mm-hmm. And for Jeff, maybe it's an unusual sound, so he would have a different reaction maybe to somebody else who hears it more frequently and either views it as something they want to fix or something that's an attack on them personally or whatever. So yeah, the personal conditions, like Corey said, would have a lot of input here too,
I would think. Yeah, I think that is important, especially when you're talking about the mind door and, you know, when you're past the immediate sound, the next thing that happens is in the general sense conditioned by everything that you know and have been through and are. And that's why that chaos ball kind of works, because that's how many options there are and how personal it is. So I think you're right. In each strand of that, we would have a whole different lineup of the 24. So if we're trying to look at though just a fear reaction, a sound, a fear reaction, a very quick reflexive moment, then you know, we're trying to narrow it down and see which of the 24 are there. But I think that you can't really narrow it down. Things happen too quickly in the beach ball chaos picture. Yeah.
I guess, would it be more accurate to say to like the recognition of the sound itself, that it wouldn't be a nutriment, but in the condition that arises from that, as in a reaction of fear, like that seems like that's a nutriment for that state, mm-hmm. You know.
And remember, nutriment supports the state, it doesn't create it. So maybe what you would say is that some of those past experiences like would maybe support the state, maybe kind of make it stronger, make it last longer through more cittas. Yes, and contact as the fourth nutriment does kind of strike me here too, because you know, this was a strong experience of a sensory contact. So maybe it does sort of support if the particular state is emotionally reactive based on a zillion things. So we might throw in nutriment. We're having trouble leaving any of these out, but yeah, I think I'm still not liking faculty for it, but I think nutriment we can make a case for. And then we get into jhana and path conditions, which don't seem relevant here. Are we kind of in agreement with that? And then you get into the, no?
No.
Oh, are you saying no, not
in agreement? Yeah, oh, I agree.
Yes, sir. Yeah. And then we get into these kind of technicality ones. So this one this list breaks it down, but I think we would have dissociation condition because the material phenomena led to the mental state. And association condition is kind of a different meaning, but it didn't exactly happen at the same time. So for the same reason, I think it's contiguity, I don't think association works. This is like playing some really elaborate game, isn't it? It's, you know, back to Dungeons and Dragons today.
I was feeling like it's guess who, like, is he wearing a hat? No.
Yes, right, exactly. Right. I was playing 20 questions the other day for some reason, and this is like 24 super difficult questions. Yeah. So presence condition, it breaks into all these kinds of presence. But again, presence is like conascence. So I don't think so. Absence describes the relationship between the sensory experience and the reactive emotional experience. So I'm kind of good there. Okay, help me straighten out disappearance and non-disappearance, someone, anyone. I think it's disappearance, the relationship between the sensory event and the mental reaction, because the sensory event ended before. But these ones are like kind of like, yeah, moving things around. But this is a really good idea. And while we may or may not be classically accurate, does it help to kind of flesh out what some of these conditioning variables are?
Yes, and I'm still hung up on the point at which Jeff decides that it's not a shotgun, it's not guns, it's fireworks. So all this is happening before we've gotten to, is it the 29th, Sheeta? Determining.
Oh, well, okay, you're mixing some levels here. Yes. Yeah, this is everything we're describing is before before Jeff goes, oh, it's just fireworks. We're still in that moment when he's like, oh my God, what was that?
Okay.
But the 1 through 17 have happened probably a bunch of times. There was a 1 through 17 that happened right when he heard it.
Yes.
And then there's this 1 through 17 happening with what entered at the mind door. There could be like a bunch of them. I can't even estimate on that, but a bunch of them could happen. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It all jumped into just a few in a moment. All of this is jumping around together.
Yes. Remember the rate of this, you know, that what we looked at, that 1 through 17 happens in about a fourth of a second. So how long does it take? And it does take a little time. It's about the same amount of time, actually, for you to startle. It's about a third of a second. So maybe let's look at it as a third of a second startle. Let's look at it as the second round of 1 through 17 that we're investigating. The first round of 1 through 17 was the raw sensory experience. And then we're having at the mind door another round of chittas. And that's what we're looking at. And we're looking at the causation between that first round and this round. Yeah. We're not looking at within the steps. Yeah, life occurs on so many scales. Do we have time? I just want to say, like, if we were talking, let's quick whip through a practice experience. Okay, say you're sitting and you, I have no idea how this is going to pan out, but say you just have an intention moment where you bring in right view. Just that little moment where you zoom out. Okay, and it's, I guess, would we have to say what it was preceded by to work this?
Yeah, I think so. Otherwise, it's still gonna be kind of a opinion based.
Yeah, what's conditioning what?
I'm guessing unprompted cheetahs are different in this circumstance. Is that like sort of in relation to just an unprompted thought that just arises, but it's wholesome? So it could be like an unprompted kusala thought.
Mm-hmm. That's what I'm thinking. Yeah, so could we look at the conditions of that arising just in itself, an unprompted citta? You know, I really don't know. If we have to look at the citta before, I don't think we have to look at the citta before, because some of these, you know, are not necessarily citta based. So let's just say we're looking at that moment itself. Because maybe it's a moment with a root condition, but no object condition. Okay, so it does have a root of wisdom, but it doesn't have an object. Let's just say it's not reactive to an object event. So we're gonna knock out all those. I really don't know about the sequencing. I think the point I want to make, if I can just skip over all the points that I don't know about, is that we would be having some repetition, some karma, and some jhana and path conditions in that moment. That, and they don't get used so often, so I just kind of wanted to bring them in. There's a, you know, just a force of the concentration that is a conditioning thing out there, and that would be in that moment, and path too, because it is a moment along the path. So I think I can't break that one down anymore, but I just want to bring it in as an example of those, because we hardly ever get to use them, and I don't want them just like left in the closet. So, you know, if you have something that, you know, we're working with some tough examples, if, you know, like, just like the homework thing, if you had a greed-rooted, unwholesome citta, you know, with all those kind of definite qualities, it would be easier to see, but I think these make it more rich to see. And I guess I'm wondering, I'm gonna take this down. How's everybody? Are there any more questions on it or thoughts about all of this different brands of glue to, because it's not just moving between the cheetahs, it's moving between the very elemental pieces of the states too. So
all right. Go ahead. Sorry. I thought you were done.
Yeah. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, I think going through Jeff's scenario helped out a lot. I know there's a lot of stuff that is personality based, maybe, or personal. So if we were to go through a list again, I think it's easy to put like conditional situations, but there are some things that are going to be hard locked into it. So I think going through that scenario helped out a lot, you know, because I could read through the sheets and I could, you know, listen to what you said, but put it into practice helped out.
Right. Well, thanks for the question, Jeff, because I think it did help. But remember, we're operating on different scales. Like there are some of these conditions that just have to do with the citta relationship with the cetasika. They're so teeny, but there's a, you know, we could go through the 24, remember, like mutuality and conescience and all that. That just has to do with that little phenomena. And now we're talking about bigger phenomena. When you're bringing in personality, the causations of personality are just beyond what we can even begin to imagine. But that is, but all of these factors are still in there. So when we, I think we picked a nice medium kind of size example when you look at the potentials here. Because it brought in a little bit of the person, Jeff, and it also brought in just a momentary experience of the person, Jeff. But if we get bigger stuff and causation, then we're off to the races, and it's very, very interesting. But that's like I was saying before about writing the list from breakfast to cosmic, all of the factors affecting you right now are beyond what we can even estimate or imagine. And yet we're swimming in all of it and moving with it. And remember, we're turning from one moment to the next, even in our confusion. Any other thoughts before we wrap up?
I think for me, I will start reading the Patana chanting. I think they have quite many examples in there.
Yes, I think so too. It really shows which ones are used in which scale. Yes. And I think that is very helpful. I was feeling the same thing, Lisa. Yeah, that would be very helpful. I really thank you, Bhante, for bringing it in and for, you know, chanting for us. So we got the energy for our last stint here of the day. But we've really, really absorbed a lot. And this causality, you know, like everything, take it all in. And then, you know, there's only two things you need to do with it. Hold it and let it go. You know, so just take it in and then just let it go, and it will affect you. And it'll keep you moving more from one moment to the next, and not getting snagged on anything in particular, but also not missing anything in particular. So those particulars are what our life is made of. So how about we all just go relax for the night? You've been so, I thank you all so much. Your participation and your discussion is just wonderful. And Bhante, thank you for keeping us afloat here in the depth of this, because you really did. So be well, everyone. Thank you. And we're back in 2 weeks, and I'll post all a bunch of stuff on Slack later.
Okay. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Be well, everyone. Take care.